Dear students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Rajkishore Sharma from Chemistry Department, University of Delhi. Today, we are going to discuss about the module Introduction to X-ray Diffraction. This is under the paper of Surface Analytical Techniques 2. In an introduction, we will discuss the basics of X-ray diffraction, advantages of X-ray diffraction. We will also discuss how it acts as a bridge between physics, chemistry, and biology. We will also have a look on Young's double slit experiment and the Bragg's law. X-ray diffraction, or XRD, is a rapid analytical technique primarily used for phase identification of a crystalline material and can provide information on unit cell dimensions. The analyzed material is finely grounded, homogenized, and the average bulk characteristics is determined. The topic which we are going to discuss today, we will start with the introduction of XRD, what exactly XRD is, then we will have a look on the history of X-ray diffraction. It involves the step-by-step development and advancement of the technique. After that, we will discuss the basic crystal system and the Bravais lattice. On the next slide, we will discuss the crystal planes and how to find Miller indices. Moving further, we will study about the classification, advantages, and applications of XRD. As XRD comprises of two words, that is X-ray and diffraction, our next two slides will discuss the basic of X-ray and its diffraction. Then we will discuss the basic principle of X-ray diffraction, including the Bragg's law. After that, we will study about the different X-ray diffraction methods, namely the Laue photographic method, Bragg's X-ray spectrometer, rotating crystal method, and powder method. To begin with, I would like to give you the brief introduction about this technique. As we know, there are many surface analytical techniques available. However, XRD is an important tool in the field of material characterization. X-ray diffraction relies on the dual, that is, wave or particle nature of the X-rays to obtain information about the structure of a crystalline material. A primary use of this technique is the identification and characterization of materials based on their diffraction pattern. It gives information on the atomic scale for both crystalline and amorphous substances. XRD reflects the periodicity of the crystal architecture. Any imperfection in the crystal structure can be easily identified by the X-ray diffraction patterns. This technique is also useful in biochemistry to solve the 3D structures of the complex biomolecules like DNA, RNA, etc. Therefore, XRD is the technique that has wide applications, and this bridges the gap between physics, chemistry, and biology. Now we will have a look on the history of this technique. German physicist Wernher Röntgen is known as the discoverer of X-rays. His discovery was dated in 1895. Because he was the first to systematically study X-rays, he is also the one who gave them the name X-rays. The image on the slide is the first X-ray image of Röntgen's wife's hand. He took it on 22nd December 1895 and presented to Ludwig Zehnder of the Physics University. Then in 1914, first X-ray diffraction pattern of a crystal was made by Knipping and von Laue. After that, in 1915, Bragg developed a theory to determine the crystal structure of the diffraction pattern. In 1953, DNA structure was solved by Watson and Crack. Nowadays, diffraction is improved by computer technology. Methods are used to determine atomic structures, and also there is a wide application of this technique in medical system. The different crystal systems and Bravais lattices. In crystallography, the terms crystal systems, crystal family, and lattice system each refer to one of the several classes of space groups, lattices, point groups, or crystals. In three-dimensional space, there are 14 Bravais lattices. These are obtained by combining one of the crystal families with one of the centering type. The centering types identify the locations of the lattice points in the unit cell as follows. The primitive, we represent it by P, these lattice points on the cell corners only. Sometimes these are called simple. Then the base centered, which is A, B or C. Lattice points on the cell corners with one additional point at the center of each face of one pair of parallel faces of the cell. Then the body centered. Lattice points on the cell corner of the one additional point of the center of the cell. Then face centered. Lattice points of the cell corner with one additional point at the center of each of the faces of the cell. Not all combinations of the crystal families and centering types are needed to describe all the possible lattices, because several of these are in fact equivalent to each other. In this sense, there are 14 possible Bravais lattices in three-dimensional space as shown in this slide. What are Miller indices and how we find it? Miller indices form a notation system in crystallography or planes in crystal Bravais lattices. In particular, a family of lattice planes is determined by three integers h, k and l, the Miller indices. They are also written as h, k, l. Now, how to find Miller indices? First, find the intercepts of the plane with the crystal axis, then express them as integral multiple of base vectors. Second step is, take the reciprocal of the three integers found in step 1. If possible, reduce these to smallest set of integers h, k and l. After that, label the plane h, k, l, the Miller indices. H, k, l represents a point. Note the exclusive of commas. Negative number or directions are denoted with a bar on top of the number. HKL represents a direction. HKL represents a family of direction, and this also represents a plane. HKL is also used to represent a family of phases. X-ray diffraction techniques are classified into three categories. The first category is based on the physical nature of the sample. That is divided into two. The first is powder or polycrystalline diffraction, which is known as XPRD or powder X-ray diffraction. The other is single crystal diffraction crystallography. On the second category is the based on the sample size. There are two types, small molecules or chemical crystallography, macromolecules or biological protein crystallography. The third category is based on the method of data collection. Data collection in two types, that is first at room temperature, which is called XRD, and the other is cryogenic XRD. This is specially used for protein. Advantages of XRD are that a material can be identified easily in a non-destructive way. Sample preparation is very easy. You can grind a small portion of your sample as little as 15 milligram to create a powder and place it in the analyzer sample chamber. The process is so easy that even a non-lab personnel can quickly acquire important data. Computer-aided material information is also available for reference. Large library of known crystalline structures is useful to a larger extent. Among the importances of X-ray diffraction technique, the X-ray diffraction is important for a material scientist working in the areas solid state physics, biophysics, medical physics, chemical and biochemistry, to name a few, whereas this technique is widely employed in R&D. The application of X-ray diffraction. First of all, it is widely used to know the structure of a crystal or the crystalline structure of a material
what phases are existing in that, and to map a material that what are the possible elements present in this. Second application is polymer characterization. XRD helps to know about the degree of crystallinity. Non-crystalline portion scatters X-ray beam to give a continuous background, whereas crystalline portion causes diffraction lines that are not continuous. Thirdly, XRD is used to test the metals without removing the part from its position and without weakening it. Next is the particle size distribution. Equation for spot counting method is V is equal to V delta theta cos theta divided by 2n, where the small v is the volume of individual crystallite, capital V is the total volume irradiated, and the small n number of spots in the diffraction ring, and delta theta is the divergence of X-ray beam. Last is the miscellaneous application, which are involved in analysis of industrial dust, assessment of weathering and degradation of minerals and polymers, study of corrosion products, structure of DNA, RNA, etc., etc. Now we will discuss about the X-rays, the characteristics of X-rays. X-rays are high energy electromagnetic radiation, which have energies ranging between 200 electron volt to 1 MeV. Therefore, these rays lie between gamma and UV rays in the electromagnetic spectrum. Interaction of external beam of electrons and the electrons in the shell of an atom produce X-rays. Each photon has an energy, capital E, which is proportional to its frequency nu. So we can write E is equal to h nu, where h is the constant of proportionality, that is Planck's constant, and its value is 6.626 into 10 raised to the power minus 34 joule second, or 4.136 into 10 raised to the power minus 15 electron volt second. Also, frequency is related to the wavelength lambda. Therefore, the wavelength of X-rays can be written as lambda is equal to hc by e, where c is the speed of light and its value is 2.998 into 10 raised to the power 8 meters per second. The production of X-rays. X-rays are produced in X-ray tube. X-ray tube is a vacuum chamber which consists of two metal electrodes. On heating tungsten filament cathode, which is present at high negative potential, electrons are produced and are accelerated towards the anode, which is present at ground potential. These high velocity electrons then collide with water-cooled anode on striking the anode. Loss of energy occurs, which is manifested as X-rays. Less than 1% of electron beam is converted to X-rays. Rest is dissipated as heat in the metal anode. Diagram of X-ray tube is shown on this slide.
Next topic is the diffraction. Diffraction is defined as bending of light as it passes around the edge of an obstacle or aperture into the region of geometrical shadow of obstacle. The bending of light depends on the ratio of wavelength of the light to the size of opening. According to Huygens-Fresnel principle, diffraction is described as the interference of waves. Diffraction occurs with all waves, including electromagnetic waves, visible light, X-ray, radio waves, sound waves, water waves, etc., etc. The effect of diffraction are often seen in everyday life. The most striking example one can see is the diffraction. Those involve the light is the closely spaced track on a CD or DVD that acts as a diffraction grating to form a familiar rainbow pattern when looking at the disc. The speckle pattern, which is observed when laser light falls on an optically rough surface, is also a diffraction phenomena.
How the diffraction process works? Interaction of the wave with a single particle. Incident beam scatter uniformly in all directions. Number two, interaction of wave with solids, that is, scattered beam interfere constructively in some direction that produces diffracted beams. Random arrangements cause randomly interference that does not produce distinctive pattern. Then crystalline particle. Crystalline particle with regular arrangement of atoms produces regular diffraction pattern. The diffraction pattern gives information about the structure of the crystal. Now, the diffraction and the scattering. There is a difference between scattering and diffraction. Diffraction is a coherent process and scattering is an incoherent process. Diffraction requires that the surface or medium is regular on distances comparable to the wavelength of light being diffracted. In comparison, when an interface or surface is rough on length scale comparable to the wavelength of light, the light will scatter. Diffraction is a phenomena observed only in waves, but scattering is a phenomena observed in both waves and particles. Diffraction is a property of propagation of waves, whereas scattering is a property of wave interactions. Diffraction can be taken as evidence for the wave nature of light. Some forms of scattering can be taken as evidence for the particle nature of light. Diffraction is very much clear from the images which is shown in the slide that diffraction occurs when an incident radiation strikes a crystal and scattering occurs when incident radiation strikes a particle. Now we will discuss about scattering techniques. X-ray scattering techniques are non-destructive analytical techniques. They depict the information about the structure of the crystal and their chemical composition. These techniques are based on the intensity of scattered beam that strikes a sample as a function of incident and scattered angle, polarization and wavelength of energy and wavelength or energy. X-ray diffraction is a subset of X-ray scattering. There are two types of scattering techniques named as elastic and non-elastic scattering. What is elastic scattering? Elastic scattering is a form of particle scattering. In this scattering process, the kinetic energy of a particle is conserved in the center of mass frame, but its propagating direction is modified by interaction with other particles and or the potentials. And now, what is inelastic scattering? It is a fundamental scattering process in which the kinetic energy of an incident particle is not conserved. That is, in contrast, elastic scattering. In an elastic scattering process, some of the energy of the incident particle is lost or increased. Young's double slit experiment. What the experiment is? In 1801, Young devised and performed an experiment to measure the wavelength of light. Light was passed through two parallel slits and two coherent beams were obtained. Then these beams were allowed to interfere and a pattern of bright and dark line was obtained on the screen placed beyond the slits. Separation of these lines depends on the wavelength and the spacing d between the slits. So d sin theta is equal to m lambda, where m is equal to 1, 2, 3 and so on. This is for constructive interference. In other case, d sin theta is equal to m plus half into lambda, m is equal to 1, 2, 3 and so on in the destructive interference.
Now about the Bragg's law. When X-rays are scattered from a crystal lattice, peaks of scattered intensity are observed which correspond to the following conditions. Number 1, the angle of incidence which is equal to angle of scattering. Number 2 is the path length difference which is equal to an integer number of wavelength. The condition of maximum intensity contained in Bragg's law above allow us to calculate details about the crystal structure, or if the crystal structure is known, then to determine the wavelength of X-rays incident upon the crystal. Bragg's diffraction occurs when the radiation with wavelength comparable to the interatomic spacing is scattered in a specular fashion by atoms of crystal system and undergoes constructive interference. The path difference between two waves undergoing interference is given by 2d sine theta. Bragg's law describes the condition on theta for the constructive interference to be at its strongest. A diffraction pattern is obtained by measuring the intensity of scattered wave as a function of scattering angle. Very strong intensities known as Bragg's peaks are obtained in the diffraction pattern at the points where the scattering angle satisfied Bragg's condition.
Now, the derivation of Bragg's law. Bragg's law is an important law in X-ray diffraction. This law can easily be derived by considering the condition necessary to make the phases of the beam coincide when the incident angle equals and reflecting angle. The rays of the incident beam are always in phase and parallel up to the point at which the top beam strikes and top layer at atom Z, as shown in figure. The second beam continues to the next layer where it is scattered by atom B. The second beam must travel the extra distance AB plus BC if the two beams are to continue traveling adjacent and parallel. This extra distance must be an integral n, multiple of the wavelength lambda, for the phases of the two beams to be the same. So we can say n lambda is equal to AB plus BC. Recognizing D as the hypotenuse of the right triangle ABZ, we can use trigonometry to relate D and to the distance AB plus BC. The distance AB is opposite to AB is equal to D sine theta, because AB is equal to BC. Therefore, we can say n lambda is equal to 2 AB. On rearranging, we have n lambda is equal to 2d sine theta, and the Bragg's law has been derived as n lambda is equal to 2d sine theta. This is the Bragg's law, where n is the order of reflection, d is the interplanar spacing, theta is the Bragg's angle. In 1915, William Henry Bragg and William Lawrence Bragg were awarded the Nobel Prize for their contribution to the crystal structure analysis. They were the first and so far the only father-son team to have jointly won the prize. The XRD methods. There are four types of methods. The Loewe photographic method. The second is Bragg's X-ray spectrometer. Third is rotating crystal method. Fourth is powder method. Now we will discuss each in details. In his first experiment, Max von Loewe, who won Nobel Prize in 1914, used continuous radiation with all possible wavelengths to impact on a stationary crystal. With this procedure, the crystal generates a set of diffracted beams that show the internal symmetry of the crystal. In these circumstances, and taking into account the Bragg's law, the experimental constants are the interplanar spacing d and the crystal position referred to the incident beam. The variables are the wavelength lambda and the integer n. N lambda is equal to 2d sine theta. Thus, the diffraction pattern will contain for the same spacing of d. The diffraction pattern will contain the diffracted beams corresponding to the first order of diffraction, n is equal to 1, of a certain wavelength. The second order, n is equal to 2 of half of the wavelength, that is lambda by 2. And the third order, n is equal to 3 with wavelength lambda by 3, etc. Therefore, the Loewe diagram is a simply stereographic projection of the crystal. The Loewe photographic methods. The images are shown in the transmission mode.
Next topic is the Bragg's X-ray spectrometer. Bragg's spectrometer used to determine the wavelength of X-rays is shown in the figure. It is similar in construction to an ordinary optical spectrometer. X-rays from an X-ray tube are made to pass through two fine slits S1 and S2, which culminate into a fine pencil. The fine X-ray beam is then made to fall upon the crystal C, mounted on the spectrometer table. The table is capable of rotation about a vertical axis, and the rotation can be read on a circular graduated scale S. The reflected beam, after passing through the slit S3, S4, enters into the ionization chamber.
Bragg's X-ray spectrometer. The X-rays entering the ionization chamber ionize the gas, which causes a current to flow between the electrodes, and the current can be measured by galvanometer G. The ionization current is a measure of the intensity of X-rays reflected by the crystal. The ionization current is measured for different values of glancing angle theta. A graph is drawn between the glancing angle theta and the ionization current. For certain values of glancing angle, the ionization current increases abruptly. The first peak corresponding to first order, the second peak to the second order, and so on. From the graph, the glancing angles for different orders of reflection can be measured. Knowing that the angle theta and the spacing d for the crystal wavelength of X-ray can be determined. Third one is the rotating crystal method. In the rotating crystal method, a single crystal is mounted with an axis normal to a monochromatic X-ray beam. A cylindrical film is placed around it, and the crystal is rotated about the chosen axis. As the crystal rotates, set of lattice planes will at the some point make the correct Bragg's angle for the monochromatic incident beam, and at the point a diffracted beam will be formed. The last point is, the reflected beams are located at the surface of imaginary cones. When the film is laid out flat, the diffraction spots lies on horizontal line. What is the powder method? The powder method is used to determine the value of the lattice parameters accurately. Lattice parameters are the magnitude of the unit vectors A, B, and C, which define the unit cell of the crystal. If the sample consists of some tens of randomly oriented single crystals, the diffracted beams are seen to lie on the surface of several cones. The cones may emerge in all directions, forward and backward. A sample of some hundreds of crystals, that is a powder sample, show that the diffracted beams from continuous ones. A circle of film is used to record the diffraction pattern, as shown in the slide. Each cone intersects the film, giving diffraction lines. These lines are seen as arcs on the film.
For every set of crystal planes, by chance, one or more crystal will be in the correct orientation to give the correct angle that satisfies Bragg's equation. Every crystal plane is thus capable of diffraction. Each diffraction line is made up of a large number of small spots, each from a separate crystal. Each spot is so small as to give the appearance of a continuous line. If the crystal is not grounded finely, the diffraction lines appear speckled. Now, to finally summarize, what we have learned today is that the XRD is an important tool in the field of material characterization. It gives information on an atomic scale from both crystalline and amorphous substances. In three-dimensional space, there are about 14 Bravais lattices. X-rays are highly energetic electromagnetic radiation, energy ranging between 200 electron volt to 1 mega electron volt. Interaction of external beam of electrons and the electrons in the shell of an atom produces X-rays. The diffraction is bending of radiation as it passes around the edge of an aperture into the region of geometrical shadow of the obstacle. There's a difference between scattering and diffraction process. Bragg diffraction occurs when the radiation with wavelength comparable to the interatomic spacing is scattered in a specular fashion by atoms of crystal system and undergoes constructive interference. In 1915, William Henry Bragg and William Lawrence Bragg were awarded the Nobel Prize for their contribution to crystal structure analysis. They were the first and so far the only father-son team to have jointly won the prize. Thank you.